shower. Oh, there it is. Showers and blessings we need. There they come. Maybe he should sing us Sunlight, Sunlight in My Soul Today. That'd be good. See if you knew that one. See? Oh, we're singing I'll Fly Away, he said. So maybe like the canopy today. The wind was out here blowing. And we put the canopy off the bus. And the wind caught the canopy and threw it over the bus. And you know, like you ever see those little slap bracelets? You see those slap bracelets, you know, the things you slap on your wrist and they'll wrap right around it? Well, that's what the canopy did with the bus. It formed to the opposite shape of the bus, and just like that, wrapped around it. So our canopy on our bus is messed up now because of the flying away. You ready? What are we singing?
I'll fly away.
All right, let's stand up and sing it tonight. I'll fly away. Some glad morning when this life is o'er, we'll fly away.
All right, sing it out. Here we go. Some glad morning when this life is o'er, I'll fly away to a home on God's celestial shore. I'll fly away.
Single day, and of course God knows we need this rain around here, and so we thank the Lord for the rain. I think tomorrow night it's supposed to be another nice evening, and so we'll make it through tonight. And we know our tent has some holes in it because we got some water coming in on some of the seats, but for the most part we're pretty dry under here, aren't we?
Amen.
And the fellas were apologizing for the speakers and everything. We're trying to keep all that as nice and dry as we can, all the electric and all that. And so if something squeaks tonight a little bit, it doesn't sound as clear, you have to understand we're working on it, trying to get it all nice. And hopefully you'll be able to hear us. That thing starts coming down pretty heavy. We'll just have to talk louder, sing louder, preach louder. Amen.
Yeah.
And just get a little bit louder. And anyway, let me just remind you, if you're visiting with us or your first time here, we do have some things. We have water bottles over here for you. If you'd like a water bottle, they're free. The offering bucket, is that over there? I can't see it. Is the offering bucket? All right, the offering bucket's over there. If you'd like to put something in the offering, help cover the expenses of the meeting, feel free to do that. We've got one more night, and we want to send our evangelists, our families away, just treating them right, and so help us to do that. And so don't forget about that. Restrooms, I hate to tell you where they are. They're in the main building over here. And so, if you have to use the restroom, you just have to figure that out. I'm not, you know, but hopefully it'll stop raining. And you can make it over there, or go over there with an umbrella. We're going to drive the kids over. So when we take the kids over, they're going to actually meet in the church building over there. And that's why the van's right here, so we can just shuttle them right over when we dismiss the children in a little bit. And so we'll be able to do that for the kids. But it's been a great week, and God's worked in a great way. We're very grateful for it. Amen? All right, let's pray together and ask the Lord to bless the service tonight. Brother Finkhart, why don't you lead us in prayer? Use the microphone, because I realize this, people out in the car can't hear us all that well, especially tonight, unless they have their radios on.
Let's pray. Lord, thank you so much that we can be here tonight. Lord, we just thank you for the opportunity to be under the tent. Lord, we thank you for our preachers and, Lord, the messages that have spoken to our hearts so far this week. Lord, pray that you meet with us in a special way tonight, help decisions to be made tonight that would make us more like you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
All right, you can be seated. We have the English are going to come and sing to us.
Hey, babe.
And then after they sing a couple songs, then we have Cody is going to come and preach. And I heard last year, I heard Tyler preach at the to our school. And then we heard Sam preach, I think, one night of the meetings. And he may have preached in our school last year. Or maybe it was year before. Maybe that was year before, because we didn't have school in June last year when you guys were here for camp meeting. But so it was when we had you here the first time, and those fellas did a great job, and so we're looking forward to Cody. I've never heard Cody preach, and so I'm looking forward to that. I'm really looking forward to it, and so that'll be exciting. Caleb and Miss Alita had to go back to Indiana, as Brother Harris has said. She had to see her heart doctor. Is a heart doctor in Indiana? So she had to head back to Indiana to go see the heart doctor. And so that's where she is, and that's where Cody is. And so, in case you were wondering where they may be, that's where they are. So you pray for them. Pray for safety on the road. Pray for a good doctor's visit. And pray for safety as they come back. And I guess they're heading to New Jersey from here, from Indiana, to head up to New Jersey, because that's where the Harrises are going to be next. Up in, some of you may have known Dan Bell. Anybody here know Dan Bell, Pastor Bell, up there in New Jersey? Some of you do. That's where they're going to be next. And so pray for them, all right?
Thank you.
free.
Thank you for that song, Mrs. Ingram. That was a blessing. I don't know what you're dealing with tonight, but I know this is God's answer to your problem.
Right.
Amen.
Amen.
Yes, I'm telling you, he has a plan for exactly what's going on in your life.
Yes, sir.
He knows exactly where you're at. Thank God for that. Go ahead and turn your Bibles to 1 Kings chapter 18, if you would. 1 Kings chapter 18. I want to take a second and thank you, preacher, for the opportunity to preach this evening. I thank you for that. I want to thank everyone who's prepared meals this week. The food has been wonderful. And if you look at me, you know we love food. So that's a big plus. It's been wonderful. Thank you all for everything this week. Thank you, everybody who's just had a part in everything that's gone on this week. It's been a blessing to my heart and my family, I know. So I just want to thank you all for that. And thank you all for coming out tonight on a rainy night. I know it's challenging at times. It's hard to pay attention under a rainy tent, I know that. But thank you all for being here. It shows that it really, just to be honest with you, when you come out to a tent in the middle of a field on a rainy night, it shows you who's serious about church.
Amen.
Probably shouldn't say this, it might make some meaning, but I no doubt there's some people that should be here tonight that aren't because of the rain. But I thank you for being here.
Amen.
It shows your heart that you're really looking to see God move. 1 Kings 18, if you would go ahead and stand. Let's read a few verses together, and we'll get into the thought for this evening. 1 Kings 18, we'll begin reading in verse number 36. The Bible says, "And it came to pass, at the time of the offering of the evening sacrifice, that Elijah the prophet came near and said, The Lord God of Abraham, Isaac, and of Israel, let it be known this day that thou art God in Israel, and that I am thy servant, and that I have done all these things at thy word. Hear me, O Lord, hear me, that this people may know that thou art the God, and that thou hast turned their heart back again. Then the fire of the Lord fell and consumed the burnt sacrifice, and the wood, and the stones, and the dust, and licked up the water that was in the trench. And when all the people saw it, they fell on their faces, and they said, The Lord, He is the God. The Lord, He is the God.
Amen.
And Elijah said unto them, Take the prophets of Baal, let not one of them escape. And they took them, and Elijah brought them down to the brook Kishon, and slew them there. Verse 45, And it came to pass in the meanwhile, that the heaven was black. We can claim this verse tonight. Amen. The heaven was black with clouds and wind, and there was a great rain.
Hey,
let's pray. Well, I want to speak to you for a few minutes on this thought. Revival on Mount Carmel. Revival on Mount Carmel. Let's pray. Lord, I thank you for this evening. And Lord, even though it's raining, I want to thank you for the opportunity you've given us to gather together as your people. I pray this evening you touch me. Lord, I know that in and of myself I can do nothing. And if I stand up here without your power, I'll waste time and nothing will be accomplished. But Lord, tonight I pray that I have your touch on my life and that you'd help us to be receptive to your word and that you'd help us to respond like you want us to. Oh God, we need you. We need your power. We need your touch more than ever. And God, I pray you'd help us all. Lord, help us to block out the distractions around. Help us to zero in on what you have for us tonight. And Lord, I pray that somehow you'd use me and the words you've given me to be a blessing this evening. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. You can be seated. Thank you for standing. Revival on Mount Carmel. There's been a lot of great revivals that have taken place down through the course of history. And I guess we could say that as way of revivals in the Bible, if you will, this would be one of the more notable ones, one of the more famous revivals in the Bible, if you will, or just in general, one of the more famous Bible stories in the Old Testament. It's a great thing that happened here. And the Bible doesn't say this was revival, but we can see in the essence of what revival is something being brought back to life that was dead. Someone being quickened. You understand what revival means. And no doubt that's what happened here on Mount Carmel. God moved in a mighty way. And often we hear the story, I've heard many messages on when the fire fell, and it's a wonderful, wonderful thing to look at. But this evening for a while, I'd like to look at the events leading up to this. I want to, for a few minutes tonight, look at what made this meeting with God possible. You see, meetings with God don't just happen. All right? People didn't just show up on this mountain and God, the fire fell and God moved. No, there were some things that had to take place before that happened. And by way of this message, looking at that, what made this meeting with God possible, I believe that we'll find some things that we need to bring back in our life, things that we need to do in our life if we are ever going to see God move again.
Amen.
I'm just going to say this. We need revival.
Yeah. Amen.
If you don't think, I do not mean this in a mean way whatsoever, but if you don't think you need revival, then you need it more than you even think you do.
Right.
Our churches are dying. We in general as Christians are dying. I'm not saying God is dying. I'm not saying His Word is dying. I'm saying the church of God is dying.
Right on.
We become so, I'm not trying to get ahead of myself, but I'm not trying to be mean, but we become so apathetic. We become so comfortable where we are. We don't really have a burden to see God moving. I pray to God that somehow God will break through our hearts to realize that we're not going anywhere. And if we want to see something happen for God, and don't miss it, I'm not saying that your church is dying. God is working in your church. I did not mean that way whatsoever. I'm saying Christianity as a whole, as we travel around to church, I'm ashamed to say that more times than not, we find ourselves in situations where we just seem dead as Christians.
Right.
And if we're honest with ourselves, a lot of times in your personal life as a Christian, and a lot of times, I'm going to be honest, in my personal life as a Christian, I find myself just, going with the flow. And just I'm just relaxing and just letting the tide carry me. Just kind of hanging on to the good Christians around me. And I'm just kind of coasting along in my Christianity. I'm just going to be honest. That's not going to work.
Right.
It's not going to do. Right. And we are in a desperate situation as Christians. We have got to see God move.
Amen.
But I'm going to say this. Our nation needs God. We understand that. Our nation needs God. But God is never going to move in our nation until He moves in your heart.
Come on.
God is never going to send our church revival until He moves in my heart.
Uh-huh.
God is never going to work in your home until it starts in your heart.
Right.
God has never moved on a scale where it wasn't on it started with an individual person.
You're right.
We can look at our nation all night long and say, oh, America needs revival. Oh, my church needs revival. But I'm saying this evening that you need revival. I need revival. And until we stop looking at everybody else and we stop thinking about how everybody else needs revival, until we get right with God and we get real with ourselves and realize that, oh God, I need revival. Nothing's going to change. The song we've been singing all week long, Lord, send revival. Start with me. Start with me. It has to start in our heart. I'm saying we need revival. And so, by way of introduction, I want to see just why we need revival. I want to see, look at some things right here in this passage and realize how bad we really need revival. And then the message, I believe, I hope it'll show us how we can get it. Because I'm just going to say it again, we need revival. I'm sick and tired of living my Christian life in a mundane way. I'm sick and tired of the same old, same old. And I want God, I want to see God. You see, I'm going to say this again in a minute, and I've got to hurry. I got a lot of stuff I want to say and cover in this passage, but I love hearing about what God used to do. But friends, that isn't enough.
Come on.
We can't keep living off the past of what God has
done.
Thank God He's worked in the past. But we need God now.
Yes, sir.
We need God now. So I want to see some things here in this passage about revival. Number one, by way of introduction, go with me to chapter 16 of 1 Kings. We see a wicked sovereign. A wicked sovereign. Chapter 16, verse 30, the Bible says, "And Ahab, the son of Omri, did evil in the sight of the Lord above all that were before him. And it came to pass, as if it had been a light thing for him to walk in the sins of Jeroboam, the son of Nebat, that he took to wife Jezebel, the daughter of Ethbaal, king of the Zidonians, and went and served Baal and worshipped him. And he reared up an altar for Baal in the house of Baal, which he had built in Samaria." Get this. "And Ahab made a grove, and Ahab did more to provoke the Lord God of Israel to anger than all the kings of Israel that were before him."
Mm-hmm.
According to Scripture, Ahab is the most wicked king. Up to this point, Ahab is the most wicked king in Israel's history.
Yes.
So we have a wicked sovereign. A couple things about King Ahab. First of all, he was chastised. Look with me in chapter 17, verse 1. "Elijah the Tishbite, who was of the inhabitants of Gilead, said unto Ahab, as the Lord God of Israel liveth before whom I stand, there shall not be dew nor rain these years, but according to my word." You see, because of Ahab's wickedness and how awful he was in the sight of God, there was a drought in the land of Israel.
Mm-hmm.
We'll find later that there would be no rain on the land of Israel for 3 solid years. God is trying to get Ahab's attention. He's a wicked man. He was chastised, but number two, he was calloused. You see, this famine, this drought, is his fault. It is King Ahab's fault. The reason there is no rain is because they have a wicked king.
Right.
But he never repents. He's fine with the way things are. He's so calloused in his sin, it doesn't even bother him. And Ahab never repents for a sin. His nation is dying. You don't care. He's calloused. But then number three, he was conceited. We find in chapter 18, verse number 5, I'm not going to take the time to read it right now, but King Ahab comes up with this brilliant plan to save his nation. He says, hey, Obadiah, let's go look for some grass. Maybe we'll save the animals. King, there's no rain. Your people are dying. God's, we understand, according to chapter 17, verse 1, Elijah told him that according to the word of God, there would be no rain. So Ahab, nod your head if you understand this. King Ahab knows that God's hand is against him.
Right.
King Ahab knows right and well exactly what's going on in this situation. This isn't just a random thing that's come out of nowhere. King Ahab knows exactly why this is happening. But in his conceited and calloused heart, his wicked audacity brings him to the place where he thinks that he can fix this situation. What a wicked man. He thinks that somehow his brilliant idea is going to fix the situation and that his idea can somehow overcome God's hand that's against him.
Huh.
Didn't work. This is just, you see how wicked this man really is. Right down to the core of his very soul. It doesn't bother him that God's against him. He just tries to figure out a way around it. You see a wicked sovereign. This shows me a couple things. God always punishes sin.
Yes, sir.
God always punishes sin. Whether in the heart of a in the child of God, no matter what you've done, where you are, no matter how good you think you are, God always punishes sin. My sin never goes overlooked by God. Your sin never goes overlooked by God. God always will punish sin. He always has and He always will. But not only that, I want to see that your sin and my sin, our sin, get this, always affects others.
Yeah.
Your sin doesn't just affect you. My sin doesn't just affect me. Our sin always has a negative effect on someone else around us. We need revival. Maybe you're in the place of King Ahab. Maybe your heart is so callous and cold and your sin doesn't bother you anymore. I pray that God will break you from that. Sometimes we find ourselves in a place, number two, I've got to hurry. I've got to move on. We see a wicked sovereign, but then we see a wavering saint. In chapter 18, verse number 3, we find a man named Obadiah. This is what the Bible has to say about Obadiah. We find that Obadiah is the governor of King Ahab's house. The word of God says, now Obadiah feared the Lord greatly. For it was so when Jezebel cut off the prophets of the Lord that Obadiah took 100 prophets and hid them by 50 in a cave and fed them with bread and water. So at a quick glance at Obadiah's life, it seems that everything's just fine. It seems that, hey, everything's just hunky-dory, everything's great, man. He did some great things for the Lord, and this is a great Christian man. At a quick glance, but if we take a second and examine his life and where he's at and what he's doing, we find that there's some serious issues in Obadiah's life.
Yeah.
And I'm going to say this, that most of the time we as Christians find ourselves in the shoes of Obadiah. Most of the Christians in today's generation are in the shoes of Obadiah.
Right.
Number one, Obadiah was connected to wicked people. He was connected to wicked people. We find in verse 3 that Obadiah, who the Bible says is a Christian, we find that Obadiah is working hand in hand with King Ahab. Who is King Ahab again? King Ahab is the most wicked king in Israel's history, but Obadiah is working right hand in hand with him. He's absolutely fine with what's going on. He's connected to wicked people. In whose mind is that okay? Since when is it okay for Christians to be linking up to the world? And I'm going to say that we fall into a rut in Christianity where we think it's okay. We just think it's okay to be linked up to the world. It doesn't really bother us that we look like the world. It doesn't really bother us that we blend right in with the world. It doesn't bother us that the people in the world look at us and say, you know, there's not really much difference. There's literally what they have. I'm saying that we as Christians had better get back to being separated from the world. We found ourselves in a place where we're just comfortable in the world. It doesn't bother us anymore. God help us. I know it's loud, but I hope you can get over what God's saying. It is not okay. We got to quit trying to mingle with the world. It makes me sick. And I'm on social media. I see a lot of my friends, people I know, using their social media, and it's like there's no difference. It doesn't even bother us anymore. It doesn't matter that we dress just like the world anymore. It doesn't matter that we talk just like the world anymore. It doesn't bother. We become so cold and so callous doesn't even bother us anymore. There's no difference. Oh, it's okay, preacher. Preacher, you're just old-fashioned. You're legalistic. God help us. God help us. You realize for Obadiah to blend in with the world, you realize he had to look like them? I'm going to say that again. Obadiah had to look like them. Obadiah had to look like them. I don't know who we think we are, thinking that we as Christians, as God people, who are called to be separated, think that it's okay to keep up with the latest trends and fashions. It's okay to completely forget biblical modesty. It's completely okay to forget that we're not supposed to look like the world. You had to look like them. You know something else? You had to talk like them. We see in chapter 18, verse 4, that Jezebel cut off the prophets of the Lord. She was on a vendetta against Christians. But she completely overlooked Obadiah. He had somehow to blend right in. He had to look like him. He had to talk like him. We got to watch the way we talk as Christians. When we're out and about in the world, people ought to be able to tell that we're different just by the way that we talk. Amen. Amen. You know something else? He had to act like him. Let's just say, I know we ought not go around acting like, you know, we're better than everybody else. There ought to be a certain amount of dignity in our heart, right, in our life. Do you understand what I'm saying? We shouldn't be walking around like worldly thugs. God help us. God help us. There ought to be something different about our life. There ought to be something different about us. We see that Obadiah, he blended right in. Didn't bother him. Go ahead. I'm not going to take the time. I'm running out of time already. But we can go to 2 Corinthians chapter 6. And God tells us very plainly that our life, God has called us to be separate from the world.
Right.
We are not to blend in. We got to quit trying to mingle with the world. You know why God isn't moving like He used to? Because we're just comfortable blending in with the world.
You're right.
I got to move on. He was connected with the people. But, by the way, the Bible says you cannot serve God and man.
You're right.
It can work for a little bit, holding God's hand and holding the world's hand. You know, it may seem to work okay for a little bit. You can have somebody fool for a while, but it's not going to work. It does not work. Cannot serve God's name. He was connected with the people, but he was content with his work in the past. In chapter 4, the Bible tells us that what Obadiah did in the past, he saved a bunch of prophets of the Lord and ended up saving their life from Queen Jezebel, who was against them. We find that When King Ahab sends him on a mission to find some grass, he runs into the man of God. And he's confronted with a real Christian. And just reading the story, we can see it makes Obadiah very uncomfortable. Have you ever noticed that when you run into somebody at the store who acts one way on Sunday, but they're acting like the world the rest of the week, you run into them and you're a real Christian and you see them and, oh, it just makes them so uncomfortable. You can see it. You can feel it. They don't like, fake Christians do not like being around real Christians. It bothers them.
Yeah.
Look at me in verse number 13. Obadiah, this fake Christian, runs into the man of God, and this is what he says. Was it not told, my Lord, what I did when Jezebel slew the prophets of the Lord, how I hid 100 men of the Lord's prophets by 50 in a cave and fed them with bread and water? Oh, preacher, don't you know what I used to do? Preacher, don't you know what I've done in the past? Preacher, it doesn't matter that my life completely blends in with the world. It doesn't matter that I act like them, I talk like them, I look like them. Don't you know what I used to do? He is absolutely satisfied with the past. He is not one bit uncomfortable with his life in the state that it's in. And I see in my own life and in the life of other Christians that we have become so satisfied with the way things used to be. We're totally cool with just things being the way they've always been. Just hearing about what God did in the past. Man, that great revival God did over there. Man, that's just awesome. That's great, man. God, I used to go soul winning. That's great. God did a great thing. You know, we used to have good meetings in church. God used to save souls every week. Man, it was great. But what about now? Does it now matter? Where have we lost our burden to see God do something now? I'm going to be honest with you. I find myself in this place more than I care to admit. We go from church to church to church, service to service to service. Sometimes we're in church almost every night of the week. I just can get so mundane in my Christianity. I say, we'll sing the same songs, and you know, God's moved before, so maybe, you know, God will just do something again. I'm just not, I don't have a burden to see God do things every single, I don't have a burden to see God move again and again. We've got to get out of this rut in our Christianity.
Yes, sir.
And again, don't misunderstand, I'm not saying that every Christian is this way, that every church is this way. But in general, we find ourselves in this, if we're honest, we find ourselves in this position more than we care to admit.
Yeah.
I'm running out of time. I gotta hurry.
Preach.
He's content with his work in the past. And I'm gonna say this again. I don't want to repeat myself too much. But if we never get a burden for the things of God, if we never truly get a burden to see God move again, nothing's ever gonna change.
Yeah.
Nothing is ever gonna change. Yeah. Why don't we see people saved every week like we used to?
Mm.
Why don't we see revivals in several churches at one time like we used to? Why? Oh, times have just changed, Brother Cody. God hasn't changed.
You're right.
God hasn't changed one bit. Has God lost power? No, He hasn't. We've lost a burden to see God through.
Yeah, sure.
I got to hurry. He was content with His work of the past, but He ceased from worthy position. In chapter 18, verse 22, real quickly, we see this. This is Elijah speaking to the congregation of Israel. This is what Elijah says, all right? Then Elijah said to the people, I only remain a prophet of the Lord. But Baal's prophets are 450. I got a question for you. If Obadiah was this great Christian that verse 3 tells us about, if he was still that great Christian, then why is the man of God Elijah standing alone on Mount Carmel? Why in the world does the man of God have to face the whole congregation of Israel by himself? I'll tell you why. Because when we surrender what God wants for our life to fit in with the world, every single time we will miss out on God's blessings in our life.
Right.
We can't just blend in with the world and then the next second be all in on God's program and be on board with what God's doing. It doesn't work that way.
Right.
You see, when we surrender our Christian life to fit in with the world, every single time we're going to miss out on what God has for us.
You're right.
I promise you, Obadiah could have been right beside the man of God, Elijah. But he's not. He's nowhere to be found after his confrontation with the man of God.
Right.
Because when we let the world see what God's trying to do, when we settle for anything less than God's will for our life, I promise you, we will miss out on what God wants for our life.
Get out. Come on, preacher.
When a visitor comes to your church and my church, they ought to know that we are on board with the man of God is saying.
Amen.
Right. Because when nobody answers a word, that's a guilty plea right there.
Amen.
They answer not a word. So we see the warning sounded. We see the man of God, he was focused. He didn't let Obadiah's fake Christianity bother him. Obadiah's like, oh, if you have me go talk to King Ahab and he finds out I'm a Christian, he's going to kill me. And he says, just go get him. He's focused on God's plan. He was fearless. He stands before the king of Israel. The man could take his life in a moment. And he looks right in the king's face. The king has the audacity to say, I don't want to read it. I don't take the time to read it. But King Obadiah, Ahab, looks at the prophet Elijah and says, art thou he that troubleth Israel? And the man of God looks the king right in the face and says, no, it's not me. It is you and your house that troubles me.
Right,
I was going to take a second and thank God for the men of God in my life who have not been afraid of what people are going to say, who are not worried about God's lives. You want to thank God for your man of God who has stood up to the Lord and been faithful to God. He's not afraid of what you look in your face and say, this is what you need to get right with God. This is what you need in your life.
That's right. Yes.
You want to thank God for that.
Hey,
don't not make you upset when the preacher steps on your toes. Don't thank God for me, loving me even more now than ever.
Yes.
When your man of God stood up on the platform like he did the other night and says, we got to get serious about this thing.
Yes.
We ought to thank God for that.
Amen.
Thank God for the man of God. Yes. He looked me right in the face and said, you need to get this right.
Right.
Amen. You see the message of God, it was delivered, but it was disregarded. Like I said, it's important to respond to the man of God. They didn't. And that shows us just how bad these folks are about it. And I've got to hurry because I want to share the message with you. We see the one I wanted to share. I've got to skip through this. Let's just go ahead and do the message, all right? So we see the wicked sovereign. We see the wavering sent. We see the warning sounded. And we see, by way of message, last of introduction, the way shown, all right? And I've got to hurry. I'm running out of time. All right.
You're home, right?
In what Elijah does on top of Mount Carmel, all right? He does several things, preparing the altar, whatnot. He does several things. He puts in the work before the fire ever falls, before the rain ever comes back. There was a lot that was done preparing for that to happen. And when we examine what he's done, I want to see four things. Well, there's no way around it. All right, there's no easy path for revival. We're going to see some things here real quickly that we must absolutely do to see God move in. All right? Number one, I want to share this with you. Number one, we see supplication. Verse 30, the first thing that the prophet, the man of God, does after he confronts them, after he sets this service in order, if you will, the very first thing that the man of God does is he repairs the altar.
Amen.
Let me say, first of all, the altar should have never been broken down in the first place.
Right.
But here it is. The altar in Israel has been forsaken, thank you, has been forsaken for much too long. And the first thing the man of God does, he realized, if God is ever going to move again, we've got to get back to the altar.
Yeah.
And I'm going to say it again in Christianity today, if we are ever going to see God move, and if God's ever going to work in our midst, if God ever is going to send revival, if we're ever going to see God do something great again, we have got to get back to the altar. We've got to spend time with God in prayer. There is no substitute for the power of God in our life.
Amen. Amen.
Supplication. We must get back to prayer. I'm sure we've all heard the old saying, much prayer, much power. Little prayer, little power. No prayer, no power.
Uh-huh.
We hear it, but I feel like it's just words to us.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. I'm going to be honest. I'm just going to confess them. I'm just going to confess to y'all right now. Too often in my life, I go right into church having not even thought about service.
Yeah.
I go right into church having not spent 2 minutes in prayer. God help us. God is not just going to make things happen. He can, but He calls for us to ask Him to move.
Right.
And until we spend time in God's presence, nothing is going to happen. I've been reading a book that a friend of mine gave me. It's about a pastor who was very discouraged, and he was wiped out. He was ready to quit the ministry, and his wife said, hey, why don't you go talk to your old pastor? So the book is, he spends several weeks, every Monday he'll go over to his old pastor's house, and he'll spend some time with his old pastor getting advice and encouragement. And in one chapter, the old man of God says to this worn-out preacher, he said this, spend time in his presence, then tell the world what you have seen. The world will be amazed when you tell them what you have seen.
Mm.
See what I'm saying is, there is no substitute for God's power.
No.
There is no substitute for prayer in our life. We've got to get back in his presence.
Right.
We see supplication number two. We see sacrifice in verse 33. He starts laying, Elijah starts laying in order the sacrifice that is going to be laid on this altar that he's prepared. And the thing that really catches my eye, he puts a bullock on there, really catches my eye in verse number 33. He lays the wood and he tells them to fill four barrels with water and pour it on the burnt sacrifice and on the wood. And he said, do it the second time. They did it the second time. And he said, do it the third time. They did it the third time. They pour 12 barrels of water on this sacrifice.
Yeah.
I did a short study on it, and it says in verse number 32, it talks about the trench that he digged about the altar. It says that this trench was as great as would contain two measures of seed. I did a study. I didn't really know what the measurement was there. We find that this trench would hold over 18 and a half gallons of water. What's happening in Israel right now? It's a drought. Mm-hmm. It hasn't rained in 3 years. And they're pouring. If we think about it, this ground is so dry. So all the water they're pouring in this is soaking into the ground until this trench is finally filled up. They poured over 18 and a half gallons of water on this sacrifice in the middle of a drought. The most precious commodity in Israel at this point in time is water. And they're pouring it on this altar.
Mm-hmm.
See, God didn't move until they handed over the most precious thing in their life to God.
Yeah.
The man of God realized that as long as we're holding on to the tangible things in our life,
preacher.
As long as we're holding on to the things that God wants in our life, as long as we're not willing to hand over to God what He wants in our life until we sacrifice ourselves on an altar,
come on,
nothing's going to happen. They poured out the most precious thing to them on an altar. And until we hand over the most precious things in our life, we're not really going anywhere. Sacrifice. See, we sing the song, I Surrender All. I Surrender All, I Surrender All, to Thee, my blessed Savior, I Surrender All. But while we sing this song, at the very same time we're singing this song in our heart, we're hoarding things that the Lord's put His finger on and say, I want that.
Okay.
I want that. Okay. This is going to lead to number three, we see surrender. See, once they sacrifice these things, and the man of God prayed, the fire falls from heaven. And we find in verse 38 that the man of God, verse 37, the man of God calls on God to show these people who He is.
Yeah.
And His fire falls. And finally, after so long, the people of Israel get their eyes back on God.
Yes.
And they realize that God is the one in control. And in verse,
amen.
In verse 39, when the people saw it, they fell on their faces and they said, the Lord, He is God. The Lord, He is God.
Amen.
The rain didn't come until they got on their face before God and surrendered their way of doing things over them.
Yep.
So they poured out on the altar things that were precious to them.
Yeah.
And you see, as long as we're trying to hold on to our gods and do things our way, God's never going to move.
You're right.
God's not going to move through our ways of doing things. There's only one way that God moves, and that's on His terms.
Yes.
Until we realize that God is the one who's in control, and God's the one who needs our attention, we need to get our eyes back on God, we're wasting our time. Wasting our time. They get their eyes back on God, they surrender. Then lastly, I'm done. I've got to move on. See, the only way we're going to see revival is if we get on God's terms and conditions.
Mm-hmm.
We see lastly, and I'm done. I promise. I've gone too long. We see a slaughter. We see a slaughter. And this is one of the most important things that we can get a hold of in our life. In verse 40, Elijah, I love this. See, I'm not a fighter. I don't like fighting people. I'm not trying to be a pansy. I just don't like fighting people. I'd rather just... Now, I love watching other people fight. I love it. That thrills me. I love watching football.
Yeah.
Going over each other. I love it.
Amen.
But I'm just not a fighter. But in verse 40, I love it. The man of God stands up and he says, this is the Cody version. This is the King James. But this, in essence, the man of God stands up and says, get every last one of the prophets of Baal. We're going to have a little meeting. All right? He says, bring every single one. There's over 450 prophets of Baal. And the man of God says, bring them all.
Yeah.
Bring them all. And in verse 40, they slay every single prophet of Baal. They get rid of them all.
Amen.
He didn't sit them down and say, you know, let's talk to them. Let's try, maybe they'll reform. Maybe they'll get better. Maybe they'll turn from their ways. Maybe they'll just get better. And this will fix the problem will fix itself. No, no, no. The only solution for this situation was to cut it off. Get it out. I'm going to say that we got to do the same thing off with the sin. You see, it says in verse 40, the Bible goes out of its way to say that he slew them by the brook Kishon. The word Kishon means to set a trap or to lay a snare. You see, those prophets were a snare to Israel. The God that they would constantly turn back to was Baal. They were constantly falling away from God and going back to the Baal. And Elijah realized that if we're going to get this taken care of, it's got to go. It has to go. Narrow life, as long as we're holding on to our sin, we're not getting anywhere. As long as we're just saying, you know what, maybe I'll just hold on to it. Maybe it'll get better. Maybe I can just turn over a new leaf. Maybe I can reform some. No. No, sir. No, man. The only way we're going to get rid of the sin in our life is if we cut it off.
Amen.
It's time to get rid of the sin in our life. It's time to stop stepping back in the same old snares. Yeah. It's time to cut it out.
Amen.
I promise I'm done. Let's see how we do it. How do we kill these people? How do we get rid of these prophets? But what was the major weapon in that day? They used swords.
Yeah.
They used a sword to cut off their head.
Yeah.
But then, how many did we kill? Kill all of them. It's about time in our life we take the sword of the Spirit, the Word of God, and we cut out every bit of sin in our life. I'm not saying we've got to be perfect Christians. We know we can't do that. But it's time we start getting some sin out of our life. God's not going to use a dirty vessel.
Amen.
It's not going to happen. So we let the Lord take a slaughter in the place of our heart and get rid of the nastiness and wickedness that's in our life. I know I've said it a lot, but nothing is going to happen.
Yes, sir.
Right on. You see, now I'm done. I promise. I promise. It's time that we start making excuses for our sin. It's time that we stop making excuses for the way we are. It's time that we stop making excuses for the way that our lives are as Christians. It's time that we get a burden for the things of God. Amen. We've all heard the old saying, if nothing changes, nothing is going to change. Right. We have got to get a burden for the things of God. Let's pray. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for this evening. Thank you for the word you've given us. Lord, I pray that somehow in the midst of all this chaos, you spoke to our hearts. Lord, I pray that somehow, Lord, you let us take away from this evening what you're trying to do in our life. No doubt, Lord. Lord, I know you laid this message on my heart for a reason. But God, I pray that somehow I communicated it well enough. Lord, all evening, this burden has been on my heart. Lord, In a way more real than any other time that I've preached in my life, tonight, I felt a burden on my heart to share this message to you. God, I pray that you'd help us to get real with ourselves and real with you and realize that, God, we need your hand on our life. We need you to see you move like you have in the past. Lord, I pray you'd help us somehow to get a hold of you. And I pray you'd start moving in our midst again. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen. The altar's open. We don't have a piano. But if God spoke to your heart,
let's respond to the message like the preacher said.
Come on. Let's all stand anyway. If God spoke to your heart, you don't need a piano.
Good.
Yeah.
All right, why don't you look up here for a moment. Let's go ahead and sing a song. Let's sing Victory in Jesus. We'll do it a cappella. We'll do it in the dark. I don't know if they did it that way before, but we'll go ahead and do it. Ready? Let's begin. Ready?
I heard an old story how the Savior came from glory, how he gave his life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. I heard about his groaning, of his precious blood atoning. Then I repented of my sin and won the victory.
One time in our church in Laurel, we had a guest preacher in, and how many of you remember when Kevin Bartlett preached from his flashlight? You remember that?
Amen.
He preached from the flashlight? But I came for camp meeting. I came to hear from heaven. Amen?
Right.
And I don't want to let the rain or a little bit of electricity shut us down. If you feel like you have to go, then feel free to go. That's all right. But we're going to stay here. I think the fellas, are you able to do a couple songs? Okay, they're going to sing a couple songs a cappella.
Hey.
And then I think, regardless if it starts raining real heavy again, I think we'll be able to hear Brother Harris. Amen.
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 But I think that'll be all right for us to do that. We're going to keep the lights. Miss Carol's pulled her van up a little bit closer and to give us some lights up here. And then they're bringing you a flashlight that you can sit right here. But I think that'll work for us. And you guys sing us a couple songs. And Brother Harris will preach to us, and we'll just go from there. We're not going to send the kids over there because I don't want them in that dark building. We don't have all that, the lights and things over there for the children, so they just have to stay real quick here. And like I said, if you have to leave, maybe your children are being a little rowdy or something like that, and you have to leave, just feel free to leave. But for those of us that can stay, let's stay. Amen?
Amen.
All right. Let's see. Fellas, why don't you come back up and sing a couple songs. Don't forget, tomorrow night we've got 5:30 right here at church. We've got burgers and hot dogs from Hastings Butcher Shop. We've got chips and baked beans and some drinks and things like that we're going to have for you for dinner. So come tomorrow night at 5:30. And I think that's it. You guys ready?
Yes, sir. We're
gonna what are you singing?
Beyond the Sunset.
And you like?
We'll sing something
else. Beyond the Sunset.
My heart is now thrilling with joy he is filling when I think of what's over life's sea. Our loved ones are waiting, they're now congregating beyond the sunset for me. Beyond the sunset in that bed. I'll be beyond this life will all vanish away, and the sunset will shine as the light of the day, beyond the sunset for me.
Hey.
Such comfort in knowing that I'll soon be going,
yeah,
where my soul shall forever be free. I see Jesus standing on the shore by the landing, beyond the sunset for me.
Since you can't go, how about we make tomorrow night extra spot. Is there going to be a kids program tomorrow night?
Yeah.
How about we make an extra special? I'd like to give some money towards something extra special for them. Would that be all right? And I'll let you, I don't know what to do. You're the ones with brains. So I'll give you the money, and you can do something extra special for them tomorrow night. That sound all right?
Amen.
What do you guys think about that?
Amen.
All right. Well, a couple of the older people think so. Amen. Amen. The kids say, I don't know. Can we trust him? You can trust me. You'll get it. I promise you. I don't know what it'll be, but I guarantee you, Brother England, it'll be good. I guarantee you. Amen. Well, let's real quickly tonight examine the truth and get to the house. How about it? Huh? I want you to go to the book of John, chapter number 16 with me. John, chapter number 16. And I'm going to read several other scriptures tonight. And if you can see it, you look at that verse with us, because there's one word that I need you to get a hold of tonight. Okay? One word specifically that really is the crux of the whole message. All right? One word. And so John chapter number 16, while you are there, I'm going to read. You don't need to look at it. Trust me, it will be King James only.
Amen.
Amen.
Yes, amen.
Because all the rest is King Dead only.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. But the Bible says in John chapter number 10 and verse number 10, it says, "The thief cometh not, but for to steal and to kill and to destroy. He says, I am come that ye might have life and that ye might have it more abundantly." So God is not interested in us just having life.
Right.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
He's interested in us having life more abundantly.
Yeah.
See, we like to, here's the title, I'll just go ahead and throw the title at you because I'm going to rush through this thing. But here's the title tonight. Brother Sam preached the other night on don't settle. He was talking about a different type of don't settle. Tonight I'm going to talk about don't settle. And here's the problem is we have settled for far below what God wants.
That's
for
exactly
us.
Right. Amen.
And
exactly
he said, I've come that ye might have life. And what we say is, oh, okay, well, I'll accept that. But then he says, no, you don't understand. I don't just want you to have life. I want you to have it more abundant.
That's right.
Yeah. Yeah.
So in other words, in church life, a church can be more abundant life. Personal life can be more abundant life. Amen.
Right.
And so, we see from the Word of God that God expects or wants to do a lot more for us.
Amen.
Then in John chapter number 15, he says this. In verse number 11, he says, "These things have I spoken unto you, that my joy might remain in you, and that your joy might be half empty." That you can just have joy. No, he said, I want your joy to be
full.
Okay? Now get a hold of this. He said, I want you to have life, and I want you to have it, go ahead and say it, more abundantly. You can help me tonight so I don't overdo my voice, all right? And then he said, I've come that you might have joy, but I want your joy to be
full.
That's what he said. Now we got it on this side. Let me make sure we got it on this side. He said, I've come that you might have life, but I want you to have it more abundantly. And he said, I've come that you have joy, but I want your joy to be
full.
Okay? You know what we do most of the time, Brother England, is we walk around with a half glass of joy.
Right.
And God wants you to fill that thing to where it's running over. Understand, God's full and our full are different. When he speaks of the word full in your Bible, here's what he's saying. He's saying that it's going to run over so that other people can enjoy some of your joy.
Yeah.
How about that?
Yeah.
You know, when we, I remember I used to eat a lot of cereal. I can't eat it as much anymore. But buddy, when I eat cereal, I'd feel that bowl.
Yeah. Amen.
I filled that bowl full.
Yeah. Right.
I wasn't interested in a half bowl of cereal.
Right.
I wanted plenty of people to walk by and be able to get a little extra off the sides that fell out of my bowl. Amen. Amen. And when they did, I'd smack their hands away. And I'd start saying, no, that's mine. Amen. But here's what God wants. He wants your life to be more abundantly, overflowing. Right. He wants your joy to be overflowing.
Right.
Now I'm going to give you the key as to why it isn't sometimes. You ready for it? John 16, here we are. Look at verse number, let me get to it, 24 with me. Hitherto have ye asked nothing in my name. What's the next word?
Ask.
Let's try that one more time.
Ask.
Hitherto have you asked nothing in my name.
Ask.
Ask.
Oh, wait a minute. When I do that number, that's like leading us all.
Ask.
Ask. There you go. You ready?
Ask.
There we go. Hitherto have you asked nothing in my name.
Ask.
Ask. And here's what he says. He says, ask and ye shall receive that your joy may be.
Oh,
are you getting it?
Amen.
Are you getting it? Simple truth. Here's what he said. I've come that you might have life, that you might have it more.
Amen.
He said, here, let's see, I want you to have herein. If my Father glorified, no. Yeah, that you might have, that it is, that you might have joy, that your joy might be.
Oh,
oh, that's what he said, right?
Yeah.
Here, right?
Yeah. Yes,
right.
Amen.
Right?
Right.
Right. You with me? He wants you to be.
Oh.
Oh, he wants you to have life more.
Amen.
And here in this verse is what he says. He says, hitherto he asked nothing in my name. Ask.
Right.
Why? That your joy may be.
Oh.
So what is he saying? Is he saying I'm supposed to ask for joy? No. You're supposed to ask for the omnipotence of God to be at work in your life so that you can have joy watching the omnipotence of God working in your life.
Amen.
When's the last time you got on your knees and said, God, I am tired of where I'm at. I want more from you. Herein, have ye asked nothing in my name? Ask, and it shall be given to you that your joy might be
full.
That's what the Bible said, doesn't it?
Yes, sir.
All right, now, cutting to the chase. In our Bible, we have promises from God. Here's the promise. He said, I've come that you might have life and that you might have it. You're getting there. You're getting there. You got to help me preach. I got to save my voice now. Help me, okay?
Amen.
So he said, I've come that you might have life and that you might have it
more abundantly.
More abundantly. He said, I've come that you might have joy and that your joy might be
full.
Well, how do I get joy, God? Herein. Have you asked nothing in my name? Ask. That it shall be given unto you that your joy, and it shall be given unto you that your joy may be
full.
Is this connecting?
Right.
Anybody connected
yeah.
with
yeah.
me?
Amen. Amen.
Making sense?
Yeah. Amen.
Why don't we have joy? Why is it sometimes our joy is halfway full instead of full?
Yeah.
Because we're not asking.
Right.
Help me?
No, you're
so we have a promise, and then we have a principle. Here's the principle. You ready? Three-letter word. Ask.
Yep.
Ask. Amen. Ask. Well, you know, I got this part. Ask. Well, I got this part. Ask.
Right.
Well, you know, I just feel like I'm not all that I ought to be for God. Ask.
Yes.
Amen.
Ask. Amen.
So we have a promise. We have a principle. And now we have a picture. Go to 1 Chronicles chapter number 4. In 1 Chronicles chapter number 4, now I'm cutting a lot of message out, just stay with me, I hope you can make the connection. We have a picture of what God tells us. In 1 Chronicles chapter number 4, you see a lot of important people. You can't look down through your Bible right now and see them. But later on, do some homework. Take your Bible home. Read 1 Chronicles chapter number 4, and you'll see all sorts of influential people in 1 Chronicles chapter 4, okay? Yeah. Important people.
Yeah.
Great people. People who begat. You have fathers and people who were begat by fathers.
Right.
Here's our problem. We settle for other great people's work. Well, I got a great pastor, so therefore I have a great church. Watch this. Then your church could be twice as great if you would decide it's not just my pastor's great
yes.
work, that God wants me to also be a great worker.
Amen.
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 Yes, sir.
Are you with me?
Amen.
Then my choir could be twice the choir.
That's right.
You know, if I ask God to touch my voice and use me in the choir, then my offering could be twice as beneficial if I'd ask God to help me to be able to
yes.
give what I can't give.
Yes.
All my, are you following me?
Yes.
Hitherto you asked nothing in my name.
Ask.
Good. You let me down. Hitherto you asked nothing in my name.
Ask.
Ask. Ask. Why? That you may receive and that your joy might be full.
Amen.
Aren't you tired of going to church and sitting there and it's just been the same every week?
Amen. Yes.
Come on.
Well, how can it be different? I'm not fabricating this. This is the Bible.
Amen.
How can it be different? I'll tell you how. Come to church and say, God, I want something today.
Amen.
I need something.
Yeah.
I need you to move like you've never moved. Now, in your words, you said, hitherto have you asked nothing in my name. So I'm coming to you. And I'm asking you because I want my joy to be full.
Amen.
See, when our joy is full, it influences other people.
Amen.
Amen.
You like being around a person who's like this? You walk up to them and say, yeah, I'm not going to listen to you, preacher. Let me use somebody else. You walk up to them and say, it's just a joke, okay, or just an example, all right? How you doing? And all of a sudden they look at you and say, let me tell you, and you go, oh God, what did I ask? Huh?
Come on, man.
Somebody help me there.
Yeah.
It doesn't have to be that way.
No.
It could be that you look at them and shake their hand and say, how you doing? And they say, oh, let me just tell you, it's so wonderful. God's wonderful in my life.
Amen.
Well, but I got this. But even in the midst of difficulties and trials in your life, you can still have great joy.
Amen.
Amen. Now watch this. On the pages of Holy Writ, if this man had not done something, you and I would never, ever know who he is. There are two verses that's dedicated to a man here that you never know. But because he asked. In chapter 4, verse number 9, the Bible says, look right here, stay with me. And Jabez called upon the Lord. Jabez went to God. And he said, God, things aren't too good in my life. But I know that there is a God in heaven.
Yes.
And I know that God wants more for my life
Man.
Than what I am having right now.
Right.
He said, wait, preacher. What's so special about Jabez? Let me tell you. Watch this now. Let's just examine Jabez's life. First of all, let me get my notes turned. Like I said, I've cut a lot of things out. But let's look at Jabez's plight. Jabez was born behind the eight ball.
Right. Yeah.
See, all through this chapter, Brother Hatfield, it says so-and-so begat so-and-so. So you have a begetter and you have a begat. What does that mean, preacher? You have a father and you have a son.
Right.
You got that? All through this chapter. And they're important people. You read about them. But when you read verse number 9, it does not say, so-and-so begat Jabez.
Right.
Right.
Jabez was born behind the eight ball. His name literally means sorry. His mother said, I named him Jabez out of sorrow. So here's a fella that come to the house, or come to the school, or come to the church, and in early parts of his life, everybody would look and say, there's that sorry individual. He was born behind the eight ball. He wasn't the best of the best. He was the least of the least. Oh, but you got to hang on to this. His wife, he did not have a father. He did not have a future. The Bible doesn't say, and Jabez begat somebody. So therefore, in Jabez's life, there's no future out there really with children. Come on. He doesn't have a family. He doesn't have friends. He's a sorry individual. He said, God, I refuse to be bitter. I refuse to stay where I'm at. I believe that there is a God in heaven who made me specifically for a purpose, and there is a plan for my life, and I believe that you want something for me. And the Bible says that Jabez called upon God. Now what's amazing about this chapter is he didn't just call at the end of the verse 2, the two verses. You'll find out that God Almighty heard his prayer and answered him. God blessed Jabez's life. Why? Why? Because one day he's walking along in his sorry state, and somebody said, oh, where's Jabez? And God said, yeah, I kind of forgot about him. I think I'll just do something for him. No. The reason that Jabez was blessed is because he asked. Jesus said to you, are you getting a hold of this at all? Herein. No, back up. What? Hitherto have you asked nothing in my name. Ask that you may receive, and that your joy might be full. Not a half glass. Not a quarter of a glass. But full.
Right.
Jabez said, I'm going to call on God, because right now my glass is right down at the very bottom, and I don't have much, and I am not much, but I know that God has a special plan for my life. And he called on God. Now, do you believe that? I guess not.
Yes,
do you believe that?
Yes.
That's Bible, isn't it?
Amen.
Did I read the right verses? Did I read it wrong?
Amen. Yeah.
Did I add anything to it?
No.
Did I embellish it?
No.
God said, ask.
Right on, preacher.
God said, I want you to have life. I don't want you to have it more. God said, I want you to have joy, but I want your joy to be
full.
You know what he said?
Amen.
And then he says, what a Savior. He said, you're not asked. So,
ask.
Amen.
A couple people got it. So he said,
ask.
Ask. Ask.
Amen.
But what am I asking? I'm asking God to do what only God can do in my life. It may be that I have a problem in my life that is bigger than what I am, and most problems are. And it may be that I have some kind of a physical illness. It may be that spiritually I am depleted in my life. But God does not want you that way. He wants to bless you. He wants to help you out. Because he wants
setting up, but I'm trying to get it done. We see his plight, where he was. We see Jabez's perception. He doesn't wander around in self-pity and bitterness. He's not satisfied. He must have more to, let me see if I see my notes. He must have more to come to realize that things don't look good, but God sure looks good. He says, I don't see a way through this, but God sees a way through this. And so the Bible says that Jabez called upon the name of God, and he said, oh God, I'm asking you, please do something with my sorry life.
Amen.
Now watch. Let's see what happens. Hang on, I'll get there in just a second. I didn't intend to throw that over there, but it went overboard. I guess I did too. Amen. First, somebody go rescue him, please. Amen. First Chronicles chapter number 4, here's what it says. And Jabez was more honorable than his brethren. And his mother called his name Jabez, saying, because I bear him with sorrow. And Jabez called upon the God of Israel, saying, oh, that thou wouldest bless me indeed, and enlarge my coast, and that thine hand might be with me, and that thou wouldest keep me from evil, that it may not bring me. And God granted him that which he requested.
Yeah.
Oh, would to God, let me some young people say, oh God, get around this altar, maybe sit on these chairs, whatever you gotta do, and say, God, you said it hitherto, have you asked nothing in your name? I'm asking tonight, keep me from evil, keep me from evil, keep my life pure, keep my life clean, keep my life usable for you. I want to see you use me, oh God. Not just interested in a Christian life. I'm interested in a Christian life more joy. That is, whoa. And I'll tell you, there's nothing greater joy. Nothing is greater joy than to be able to have Jesus call you and use you in the work of the living God. There's nothing greater. You maybe have aspirations to do all sorts of things in your life. Can I just tell you, young people, can I just say first, give yourself to God.
Yeah.
Oh God, here I am. I'm asking you. You said ask. I'm asking you. Oh God, take my life like Jabez and do what I can with my life. Do it, oh God, here I am. Completely sold out to you. Parents, may God help us to move from our place tonight. Find a place and say, hitherto, have I asked nothing in your name, oh Lord? But I'm asking tonight. I've got children. I've got a family. I want my family to enjoy the abundant life. I want my children to know what a church that is full of joy is all about. Oh, God, I'm coming. I'm asking you. God. Would God. We ask you, Lord, please.
Hey, can we have you guys come back up and sing something a cappella? Maybe that first song you sang. Let's all stand up and hit that.
I was thinking about how during this whole